Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents My Four Seasons in France, A Year of the Good Life by Janine Marsh. Narrated by Susan Duerden. Prologue. It all began on a freezing February day in 2004. My husband Mark and I had embarked on a day trip to Calais to buy wine with my dad Frank, who had taken to drinking way too much whiskey in order to drown his sorrows after my mum died a couple of years earlier. He was utterly lost without the love of his life, and had taken to counting every day he had been without her. Whenever we spoke, he would say, "You know, it's been 400 days since your mother died," and so on. It was so clear to me how much he thought of her and missed her every day, and I worried about him constantly. I thought that wine would be an improvement for him over the hard stuff, and that a trip with us might cheer him up a bit. And where better to pick up some wine than in France? That morning, we picked up Dad from his home, not too far from ours in southeast London, and drove down to Dover, where we boarded a ferry to France under a wretched, ominously grey sky. The miserable weather certainly didn't improve when we reached Calais, with a gale coming in from the English Channel and buffeting the coast. After we had bought our wine, we decided to head inland from the coast to find somewhere cosy for lunch. We stopped off in the little town of Aydin in the Seven Valleys, which, judging by the map, looked like it would be big enough to offer a grand choice of restaurants. Cobbled streets glistened under a steady stream of sleet, as, wrapped up against the chilly wind, we searched for a place to eat. Alas, we were too late. We didn't know it then, but restaurants in France are generally not an all-day affair, and arriving at 1:30 p.m. will likely result in a "no" when you want a table. "Blimey," said Dad, "you wouldn't want to live here, would you?" En route back to the car, soggy and fed up, we passed many cafes and bistros that looked teasingly tempting, with their warm glowing lights and oh-so-French menus. As we stopped to look at houses for sale in an estate agent's window, the agent inside must have spotted our miserable frozen faces, and so he invited us in for coffee. It was too much of an enticement for my coffee-loving dad, and we trotted in behind him. We were warmed by his generosity and the cosy interior of the shop, so the agent seized his chance.
"How much money are you looking to spend?" he asked.
I choked on the strong French coffee and assured him we had no money and we weren't looking for a house in France. Refusing to accept that we weren't interested in buying, the agent used every ounce of charm he could muster. And after realizing we were too poor to buy a house that didn't need completely doing up, he pulled out his three cheapest properties. He worked so hard to persuade us that I gave in, and, thanking him for the coffee, took the details and bade him au revoir, certain we would never see him again. Back in the car, we considered going straight home.
"Or we could just take a look at these houses. They're all under 100,000 euros, I said.
Buying a house in France wasn't something I'd considered, but a whole house for less than £60,000? You couldn't get a garage in London for that. I was intrigued, and the agent was a good salesman, piquing my interest with his descriptions of vaulted cellars, wood-panelled lounges, and bedrooms suitable for a queen. My suggestion was met with silence in the car. I wasn't sensing a great deal of enthusiasm from either of them.
"They're all in towns close to Edin. There might be a cafe open in one of them, and it's on the way back to Calais anyway, via the scenic route," I continued.
Tempted by the prospect of a local cafe that might serve hot food, the unhappy men caved in to my suggestion. We drove for 30 minutes and arrived in a town that had a single road and a town hall, but no cafe. The house for sale was in a semi-derelict state. In the next town, there were just a few houses on a single road. On peering through the windows of the apparently fit-for-royalty house, we could see that the walls, ceiling, and even the doors were covered in hideous 1970s linoleum. It looked like a serial killer's den.
The last house was in a tiny village with no shops, no bars, and no sign of life. I was starting to think that driving here to view a house we didn't want and couldn't afford, even though it cost less than an Hermes handbag, was probably a bit mad. By now, both Dad and Mark were seriously fed up. I got out of the car to peer through a broken gate set into an unattractive concrete wall. Behind the wall was a very long and low detached farmhouse-style building with drab grey walls and a concrete block extension. Paint was peeling from the windows and door, and the rain, pelting down on the moss-covered roof, spilled over gutters and gushed from a broken drainpipe. The rain-sodden front garden was filled with piles of broken bricks and rubble. The house looked abandoned. "Let's just go," said Dad. But just as I turned to get into the car, the rain stopped and a beam of sunlight broke through the dark clouds. A man came out of the house and asked in English if he could help us. The church bells in the village started to ring, and I heard ducks quacking loudly close by. I didn't know it then, but it was the sound of fate. The Englishman told us that the house was his daughter's, and he was there to check it wasn't leaking too much. He invited us in for a cup of tea and to look around what was essentially a shell of a house. The wind howled through holes in the bare concrete walls and roof, and the floors had a strange tackiness to them. The house was dank, cold, and smelled stale. The bathroom was nothing more than a filthy shower cubicle on the hall landing, and the loo was in a corner of the kitchen. "This house is not fit to live in," Dad declared as he pulled at a bit of rotting wood on the kitchen door frame. But as I peered out of the kitchen window that looked over a huge garden with wild birds flitting about, I saw fields beyond that stretched out as far as the eye could see, and a church spire in the distance. I felt a pull on my heartstrings. I had a vision of myself growing vegetables and fruit. I could see beyond the ugly rooms to admire the beautiful old oak beams that held up the ceilings and the ancient flintstone wall that ran across one of the downstairs rooms. I realised that I'd been hit by what the French call a coup de foudre, a lightning bolt or love at first sight. I could feel my heart beating wildly. I just knew that this neglected old dump had huge potential and was waiting for the right family to come along and bring it back to life. I also knew, then and there, that the family would be me and Mark. I went home in a daze. Mark was unsure about taking on such a huge project, and we discussed for hours what it would mean to buy the house and whether we could really afford it. As we talked more about the building's potential and what we could do to restore it, Mark's builder instincts kicked in. A week later, we put in an offer, and it was accepted. We sold Mark's beloved Jaguar to pay the deposit and adjusted to a reality of no holidays or treats while we poured everything into a fund for the necessary building work and repairs. 4 months after we first set eyes on it, the French farmhouse was ours, and we have been renovating ever since. Quite why I fell head over heels for a house with metal doors that flapped in the wind and rattling windows sometimes mystifies me. I'm not sure how I managed to block out the state of the building and focus on the fact that it had an acre of garden, admittedly unkempt and complete with a sheep. I'd watched those TV shows, the ones where they take a run-down old house and turn it into a beautiful and desirable home. But that sort of thing always felt like a distant dream and something I'd never do. But when I walked into the farmhouse that day, it just felt like I had been struck by fate. Although sometimes, when we're up to our elbows cleaning out the septic tank or mending our roof for the umpteenth time, it feels more like we might have been struck by something altogether less pleasant. For almost 10 years, we spent most of our weekends and all of our holidays turning our hovel into a home. We explored the local area, met the neighbours, and fell under the spell of a tranquil way of life, until we were so in love with the village, the amazing street markets, the delicious French cakes and the friendly locals, that we could hardly bear to leave at the end of our visits. we felt more and more torn between our lives in London and our feelings about this wonderful corner of France. I was about to be appointed a director at the bank where I worked. It had taken 18 years of hard slog to get there, and I knew I deserved it. I loved my job, and I felt far too young to retire. My dad said I was an idiot to even consider giving it all up. But I knew Mark was sick of never seeing me because of the long hours I worked during the week, and sometimes at weekends too. When his beloved younger sister passed away from cancer, the loss hit him hard. She loved spending time with us in France and often talked about wanting to buy a house in the village. For Mark, being able to spend time with the people you love became more important than anything, and he knew that we could make a different life in France together. In all honesty, it was a tough decision. I am not comfortable with risk, but I do believe in fate and love. There were obstacles along the way. At work, there was a big project to which I was committed, and then Dad got diagnosed with cancer. I was devastated, and I knew I couldn't abandon him when he needed me most. I went back and forth between France and the UK for 2 years, going to appointments, sitting with him through treatments, or just being there to make a cup of tea and listen when he wanted to talk. His death was a huge blow and left me reeling for a long time afterwards. But the words he'd said to me 1,000 times echoed in my head. Life is for living. Don't waste one single precious moment. And so, one warm September day, almost 10 years after we had been so sure we would never want to buy a house in France, we piled our belongings into a trailer and drove them to a little rural French village to begin a new life. This is the tale of 1 year in France, a romp through the four seasons in the lives of 2 frequently baffled but determined expat Brits. Janine Marsh. January. Oh la la land. On the first day of the new year, a heavy, freezing fog descended on the village and decided it was going to stay. The air hung, silent and cold, blanketing the houses and making the smoke from the chimneys hover over the rooftops in the absence of a breeze. Nothing much moved, except for a few hardy farmers taking food to cows hiding in warm barns, and some hungry chaffinches looking for berries in the hedgerows. The houses had their shutters closed tight against the chill. Except for a few short hours when they were swung open to let in the day, they would remain like this throughout January, preserving the warmth from the wood fires and creating a semi-twilight world for those inside. It has been this way for centuries in the Seven Valleys. That was fine by me. I wasn't going anywhere after a New Year's Eve dinner the night before at the home of our neighbours, Guillaume and Constance. We had feasted like kings and drunk like lords, and moving much today was out of the question. At 8 p.m. the night before, a customary 30 minutes later than the time we were asked to arrive, Mark and I had set off from our house, halfway up a hill in the middle of the lush Seven Valleys, rural northern France. It's been almost 15 years since we, the only Brits in the village, bought our ramshackle old farmhouse, so we knew perfectly well that arriving later than asked is an unspoken law. Nobody seems to have a clue why this is so, and I've had many discussions with my French friends about how much easier it would be if they could just tell us what time they really want people to arrive. "But this is how we've always done it," they say. "Our parents did it this way, and their parents before them." And as everyone knows in France, if it has always been that way, then it will stay that way, whether it makes sense or not. A 5-minute walk down a country lane and alongside fields encircled by frost-kissed hedges brought us to our friend's home, a fortified, stone-built farmhouse, typical of the area. We pushed open the gate, which squealed loudly in protest, making dogs howl and an owl hoot somewhere above our heads. Other than that, it was silent and pitch black. We made our way to the front door via a slippery cobbled path and pulled a long chain, which set off a ringing that we could hear faintly through the heavy wooden door. Ushered into a wood-fire-warmed dining room, we were somehow still the first to arrive, but at least we weren't too early. There had been occasions in the past when, not knowing the drill, we had turned up at the right time to find the hosts not even dressed. Thankfully, the rest of the guests, all of whom we knew, arrived just minutes after. Jean-Claude and his wife Bernadette are, whisper it, our favourites. They welcomed us to the village from day one, and Jean-Claude especially became our mentor and at times saviour. He frequently visits us, offering advice and explaining how things work around here. It was Jean-Claude who came to the rescue when we ran out of firewood in our first winter, apparently the coldest in years, and I was considering divorcing Mark due to the fact that it was his fault. I felt as if I was slowly freezing to oblivion because he had persuaded me that coming to France to live permanently was a good idea. Pushing back the flat cap that might just be glued to his head, as I've never seen him not wearing it, Jean-Claude had pursed his lips while thinking about who might have wood for sale in winter, and then ordered it for us. He told us where the best boulangeries were, the best time to plant potatoes, how to cut hedges properly, and how to make crow pâté, which, to tell the truth, is not something I wanted to learn and can't honestly recommend. Constance and Guillaume, who during the week live and work in the city of Lille, the capital of the region, inherited their village house. They loved to cook and to teach me about French cuisine. We became good friends after we met at a party where everyone was required to make and bring a tart to be judged. That is considered fun in these parts, unless you are called flop chef, not top chef, as I am. Constance had baked a strawberry tart that everyone agreed was the best they had ever tasted. Delicate, light golden pastry, creamy and sweet crème pâtissière, topped with strawberries, macerated in Grand Marnier, and dusted with icing sugar. It was like heaven on a plate. She won first prize. I had made a rather sad cheese tart that no one had wanted to eat, and came last, which was not in the least bit surprising. Constance offered to teach me how to cook, and despite several people in the village over the years already trying and failing, I can now create a passable tart thanks to her gentle patience and encouragement. Madame Bernadette, always called Madame Bernadette so as not to be confused with Bernadette, wife of Jean-Claude, a white-haired widow who lives alone in the corner house at the bottom of our hill, was sitting at the table. Next to her was old Monsieur Martel, who also lives alone. Both in their 70s, they have lived in the village and known each other all their lives, and bicker as if they were married. Jean-Claude, who is a terrible gossip, says that there has never been a romance between them, and there is hardly likely to be, as Monsieur Martel is a little rustic in his ways, whereas Madame Bernadette loves art and classical music. He keeps pigs, goats, and ornamental chickens, and she has reproduction Monet paintings all over the house. According to Jean-Claude, this is the sort of clash that can't be overcome, even though I've told him that he might be wrong. I had read that Monet apparently loved chickens. In fact, he was fanatical about them. The final guests to arrive were Paul, who is Constance's cousin, and his partner Delphine. Paul is a maths teacher and sports a permanent hangdog expression, which gives the impression he might be quite sensible, whereas he is quite bonkers. He once had to choose between his beloved pet chicken, Chérie, which lived permanently in his house and accompanied him in the car when he went to the shops, and nubile girlfriend of the time, Sylvie, who refused to share a pillow with poultry. He chose Sylvie. He's not that bonkers. But the relationship was never quite the same. Paul pined for Chérie for months until Sylvie lost her temper and dumped him for a baker from Béthune. Delphine, with her calm and placid nature, is perfect for Paul. They bonded, she says, after meeting at a flea market and spotting at the same time a book about mushrooms that they both wanted, revealing their shared love of mushroom foraging.
She allowed Paul to buy the book, and he took her to a secret forest to find fungi. One fungi led to another, and their wedding was planned for October. Constance and Guillaume brought out little canapés, tarts with baked eggs and truffled shavings, blinis with grilled herring, jellied vegetables and slices of dried sausage that were perfect with the chilled champagne. After that, it was on to the entrees, starting with snails swimming in lurid green garlic butter, so hot it was bubbling, and fresh oysters from Boulogne-sur-Mer, less than an hour away. When we sat down to the main course, Guillaume carried in a huge tureen of stew called beef carbonade, cooked with beer and brown sugar. Everyone cheered as he whipped off the lid and aromatic steam filled the room. Each course was accompanied with a wine perfectly paired with the dish. Just before 12 p.m, Guillaume counted
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
And we all kissed on the cheeks and wished each other bonne année. Mark and I hugged each other tight, but not anyone else in the room. The French don't hug, they kiss. If I had tried to hug one of our hosts or their guests, it's almost certain that a rumour would have started circulating about the weird British woman being a hugger. It's bad enough that I'm known to some people as Madame Merde after my septic tank exploded. Then it was time for the cheese, served before dessert in France. It was a beautiful display from the famous Fromagerie Cassius in nearby Montreuil-sur-Mer. A cheese course in France isn't just a stage in the meal, it's a history lesson on a plate. Local cheeses in these parts that are firm favourites include Mimolette, Maroilles, and Vieux Boulogne. Aged Mimolette, which originates in Lille and has a right royal history, is considered to be best. When France fell out with Holland in the 17th century, Louis XIV banned an import of Edam cheese and commanded that a French equivalent be made, only better. Local cheesemakers in Lille, tasked with this tall order, came up with a ball-shaped cheese with an orange rind. They also discovered they could add extra flavour by introducing cheese mites to the surface, where they dig little holes. It doesn't look or taste similar to Edam, but it stayed because everyone liked it so much, except in America, where it's banned because of the bugs. Maroilles is incredibly smelly but delicious, and was invented by monks in the town of Maroilles more than 1,000 years ago. And Vieux Boulogne, which, despite its name, is quite a new cheese, invented in 1982, is officially the stinkiest, almost fragrant if you're French, cheese in the world, according to scientists at a university in the UK. Thankfully, there was no Gris de Lille, which the locals call Stinky Grey or the Stench of Lille. Believe me, if you are ever unlucky enough to have some in your mouth, you will probably call it many names worse than that. Although, apparently, the Soviet leader Nikita Khrushchev fell head over heels for it when he visited Lille in 1960 and had a load shipped to Moscow. It doesn't actually come from Lille, but from Hainaut, near the border with Belgium. But when it was first made in the 19th century, it was sent to Lille to be preserved, developed, and packed, hence the name. Let's just say that if you like the aroma of old and sweaty socks, you'll love the Stinky Grey. We discussed New Year's resolutions over the cheese course. This being France, there is a distinctly philosophical air to many discussions. Whether your aim is to get fitter, as many of us announced, or you want to learn to speak another language, which no one announced, you must talk about it as much as you can. The French absolutely love to have long, complicated discussions, to introduce topics into the conversation that will have no conclusion, to never admit to being wrong, and to never say they don't know the answer to a question. Madame Bernadette surprised no one when she announced that this year's goal was exactly the same as last year's, and the year before. Rumour has it that she has been on a diet since 1972. Sometimes it's tough living here in the rural north of France. We're surrounded by little villages with tempted boulangeries and patisseries.
and I guarantee that the aroma of fresh-baked baguettes from a wood oven, lifted out by a ruddy-faced baker on the end of a long paddle, or the scent of flaky, buttery and golden just-cooked croissants is utterly irresistible. And then there are the cakes. Cake makers in France are craftsmen. They train for years, learning how to make perfect little edible works of art. Opera cakes, Paris-Brest, eclairs, macarons. Classic French cakes really are in a league of their own. Regions, departments, and even some towns have pastry specialities that are unique to them. Here in the far north, the merveilleux, marvellous, is a favourite. A speciality from Lille, it's a seriously sweet meringue puffball of a cake covered with whipped cream, chocolate, or other sweet things. I can promise you it requires fortitude to eat a whole one. In the little town of Bourainville, the local baker makes a cake that I've never seen anywhere else, though I'm not sure you could put it in the category of a great French gâteau. Le doigt de Charles Quint is a long sponge finger, literally. Red jam and chantilly cream ooze from the centre. It's meant to represent the gouty pinky finger of Emperor Charles V, who once ruled these parts. It tastes better than it sounds. There are even seasonal cakes and breads. A galette des rois, king's cake, is de rigueur in January, as are bouche de Noël, Yule log, in December, and cherry clafoutis in spring. I am always reading in some newspaper or other that French women are somehow able to exert superhuman strength over their appetites and remain skinny. That might be true in Paris, where, at the posh Café de la Paix next to the Opéra de Paris, I once saw a pencil-thin woman order a bowl of lettuce for dinner, as her lover, I knew because they were kissing each other with wild abandon and much flashing of tongues across the table in between mouthfuls, tucked into succulent oysters, a juicy steak, and ended with a dreamy tarte tatin. But I promise you, your average French woman, at least where I live, is quite normal and able to resist anything but temptation, just like the rest of us. Madame Bernadette loves cakes. The bread man, not a man made of bread, but the man who delivers bread and pastries to our village and many others around 3 times a week, knows this, and he is a good salesman. In January, he hardly mentions the sweet feasts he has in the back of his van. The dieting Madame Bernadette accepts her lonely baguette with a sigh. By February, she will be asking, "Do you have any millefeuille?" By March, the bread man is openly tempting her with sugar cakes, a sweet pastry baked with a thick butter and sugar topping, pastel pink macarons, passion fruit pavlovas, or a sticky and creamy coffee religieuse. The battle is lost, resistance is futile, but as Madame Bernadette says, there's always next year. Around 1 a.m, Constance brought out cakes that looked like works of art. They were from Patrick Hermond in Le Touquet, which, if you're ever in the town, you can spot by the queue of people drooling at the window over the magical display. By now, much as I love cake, I was thinking that Mark might have to roll me home in a wheelbarrow. I was aching from laughing as we played charades, the game where you have to act out a word or phrase without talking, and everyone has to guess it. But this being France, there were rules that were different from wherever else you might play it. Everyone had to act out being a celebrity. Added to that, there was a strict time limit. You had 2 minutes to present your charade, and the guests had 5 minutes to discuss and guess. Jean-Claude, Paul and Monsieur Martel were all the late great Johnny Halliday, the French Elvis Presley. And believe me, the sight of more than one rather drunken elderly Frenchman gyrating his hips to the imaginary sound of French rock and roll in a small salon in middle of nowhere France is enough to give you nightmares. Then Madame Bernadette and Bernadette were both Edith Piaf, hunched over an imaginary microphone, shaking with passion, throwing arms wide and mouths wide open in full silent song.
"No, no, no,"
said Constance, admitting she was miffed, as she too wanted to be Edith Piaf.
"We must all be someone different."
The rules were changed. You had to mind being a celebrity who wasn't Johnny Halliday or Edith Piaf. Nobody could guess that Guillaume was Jacques Cousteau, the great sea explorer, as he lay on the floor, his long, thin frame face down, a thumb in his mouth and a finger pointed straight up. Evidently this was meant to be a snorkel, with his other arm miming a diving position. And in my wildest dreams, I would never, ever have figured out that Delphine's imaginary hair-tossing and pouting lips was meant to be Brigitte Bardot. Nobody guessed that I was Joan of Arc, riding an imaginary horse and wielding an imaginary sword. But I was disqualified on the grounds that she was not a celebrity, but a saint. Mark was Quasimodo, which everybody guessed. Some hours later, I could swear I heard a cockerel crowing outside, and I noticed everyone was by now openly yawning. I found that French people are terrible at ending a get-together, whether it's an artisan who's come in for a cup of coffee at the end of a job, a neighbour who has popped in to borrow a packet of sugar, or a party. No one ever wants to be the first to say goodbye. Being British, though, we're very good at calling it a day, and announced that we needed to go home. We said goodnight and good morning, kissed everyone again, and pulled on our coats and hats. Immediately, there was a rush by everyone else to join us. A straggle of tired and tipsy villagers made their way home, pushing through the frozen air blanketing the silent village, crossing fields, along muddy alleyways, and onto the silent main road. It felt like I'd been asleep for 5 minutes when my alarm went off. There was no chance for a lie-in with animals to feed. My first job was to visit the bird pens, where my ducks, chickens and geese weren't remotely grateful or sympathetic to my fatigue and honked, clucked and quacked loudly for their own feast. Then the cats needed feeding and cuddles, the dogs needed walking and the fire needed stoking. And finally, it being New Year's Day after an all-night eat-a-thon, we could relax. That meant we got back to the job of tiling the kitchen floor. With 21 rooms to renovate, we had started with laying concrete floors inside the house and some hard standing outside so cars would not get stuck in the mud. It rains a lot here. Over the years, Mark estimates, we've laid more than 100 tons of concrete. Then we'd replaced all the old wood-framed windows with double-glazed PVC. It wasn't what I wanted. I had dreamed of lovely bespoke wooden windows, but we had 37 windows to fit, and the cost of the wooden ones would have bled us dry. And in such a damp part of France, we would have needed to paint them every year. So in the end, and after much heated debate, I caved into the sensible option. After that, we moved on to insulating the house, boarding the walls and ceilings, and plastering. Then everything had to be painted, and cupboards built, electrics installed, sinks, showers and loos fitted. Tiling the kitchen floor was the last job we had to do before that room and the adjoining walk-in pantry were finished. And we were determined that, despite my dad's prediction that this house would be a never-ending job, we would finish the entire renovation by the end of this year. Tiling isn't just tiling in this part of France. It's not just a question of nipping to the local hardware or tile shop to choose your tiles and take them home in the boot of the car. We have to drive for an hour to get to a store with a greater choice than just plain beige squares, which are a firm favourite in these parts. In the week before Christmas, we hitched up the trailer to the car, headed to Boulogne-sur-Mer on the Opal coast and to the Bricot Depot Superstore, where they know us by sight because of the amount of time we spend there buying materials. By the end of January, all the tiles were to be laid and everything in the kitchen ready to go. It would soon be our turn to host a dinner for our neighbours. The cold fog lingered for several days. The water in the dog's bowls iced over within an hour of being filled, and the pond in the duck's pen was solid. Everything liquid turned to ice, and every day I had to carry buckets of water down to the bird pens. The cats decided to hibernate in the house. Even Winston, who's known as the biggest cat in the village, came in to sleep at night, a rare occurrence these days. When I first found him under the wheels of our van in Boulogne, a tiny, bleeding bundle of fur with bright blue eyes, he'd been attacked by a bigger cat. I was totally smitten with what was my first pet. I nursed him back to health, feeding him with kitten milk with a pipette until he was well enough to eat on his own. Winston was a bit mad right from the start. If the doorbell rings, he hides. If someone comes into the house that is not me or Mark, he hides. Over the years, he's gradually become more and more of a loner, disappearing sometimes for days on end. He comes in for food as long as there is no music, no strangers are present, and the chairs in front of the door are in the same place. He really doesn't like change. During the cold evenings, he lies watching the flames dance while he stretches out on a cushion with Lazy Lulu, the tortoiseshell cat, Henry Cooper, a fluffy feline with Zorro mask-like eyes, and Shadow, the black cat. Ella Fitzgerald, who was supposed to be a spaniel but turned into a rather large German shepherd who doesn't think she is a dog at all, likes to lie on her own cushion. Bruno the Labrador lies across my feet, and Churchill the German pincher, like a miniature Doberman but yappy, joins the cats in front of the fire where it's warmest. The only cat who wasn't there in the cold spell was Hank Marvin He's Always Starvin', the one-eyed cat. He was in another room, as his incurable cat flu made him sneeze constantly, so he had an enclosed cage that was easy to clean, one of my least favourite jobs. He cast broken-hearted looks at me when I carried him through the house, and he saw the others living it up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.